During the summer of 1942, the Axis forces in southern Russia resumed their offensive, attacking through the Don steppe towards the Caucasus and the Volga. Initially, the attacks made good ground. The Soviet front, weakened by a disastrously mishandled offensive in May, buckled and then broke. But as the Axis armor and infantry poured over the plains, Soviet units, falling back in disarray, regrouped and fought a number of important delaying actions at Rostov, Voronezh, and most importantly, in the great bend of the River Don. These actions, coupled with misunderstandings and indecisiveness amongst the German high command, enabled a stand to be made on the west bank of the Volga. The place chosen was a sprawling industrial city, commanding the river traffic and the road and rail routes to the south. The Battle of Stalingrad was to be the decisive turning point of World War II. As the fight for the city developed, both Hitler and Stalin became locked in a contest of wills. Amid the rubble and carnage, their forces fought for streets, houses, sometimes even rooms. With the onset of winter came the Soviet counteroffensive, the destruction of the Romanian, Hungarian, and Italian armies, and the encirclement of the mighty German Sixth Army. In the spring of 1943, when the dust finally settled over the Don steppe and over the fire-blackened ruins of Stalingrad, Hitler's war of conquest had become a battle for survival. In Stalingrad, he had tried to break the Red Army at the furthest limit of its retreat. Instead, he had all but broken the Wehrmacht. For the Red Army, the battle was more than just a great victory. It was in every sense a turning point. Morale was restored. Officers and men enjoyed a new status and respect. And the dark cloud of failure that had dogged the army for years was dispelled. The battle also marked the beginning of the march west, the reconquest of Russia, and the drive through Eastern Europe to the gates of Berlin. With Barbarossa, Hitler had planned to conquer the Soviet Union in a single season's campaign. But by December 1941, the Red Army had still not been destroyed, Moscow had not fallen, and much of the industry and agriculture of the South still lay beyond his grasp. Now he faced a new and unfamiliar challenge. He had made no plans or preparations for a winter campaign, and no major offensives could be contemplated before the spring of 1942. Until then, his soldiers would have to hold the line, confronting the inevitable counterattacks, while supplies of winter clothing, ammunition, and low-temperature lubricants were hastily sent forward. When the first supply trains reached the front, they were met enthusiastically by men bowed down by acute shortages of essential supplies, by chronic immobility, and by the cold. But the respite was not to last. The German armies in Russia were at the extreme limit of their extension, far from their main supply bases, and vulnerable to a quick counteroffensive. The blow fell sooner than anyone expected. On December the 6th, the Russians attacked along a 600-mile sector of the front. In the first phase, the Soviet aim was to pinch out the German salience west of Leningrad and to the north and south of Moscow. Under remorseless pressure, the Germans were gradually driven back. But there was no decisive breakthrough, and in January, buoyed by his early successes, Stalin ordered a general offensive. Initially, the attacks made good ground. Soviet pincers closed around Demyansk and Vyazma, and threatening attacks were made towards Smolensk and Bryansk. But despite these early successes, the Soviet offensive soon ran out of steam. By March, the Germans had recovered, stabilized their lines, and secured the neck of the Vyazma pocket. Only at Demyansk was there any serious prospect of a major Soviet victory. Here, a large part of the German 16th Army had been surrounded. Hitler, however, would countenance no withdrawal and ordered that the 92,000 men, trapped in the pocket, hold their positions. For 10 weeks, the encircled forces were supplied from the air, enabling them to mount repeated attacks on all sides of the ring until, eventually, at the end of April, a land corridor was opened to the west. With the spring, both sides prepared to resume the offensive. While the German High Command decided to stabilize the front at Kharkov in advance of larger operations in the summer, the Russians, unknowingly, chose to attack through the same sector to maintain pressure in the south. Kharkov had been occupied in October 1941 and had already seen one Soviet counterattack. This had been carried out as part of Stalin's January offensive and had left the Russians holding a vulnerable salient on the west bank of the Donets. On May the 12th, the Russians opened their offensive with concentric attacks on either side of Kharkov. In both sectors, the attacking forces broke through and a serious threat to the city began to emerge. In response, the Germans accelerated the preparations for their own offensive, launching it 5 days later. Attacking northwards, German armored formations spearheaded a drive into the neck of the salient, slicing adrift the entire Soviet left wing. In the last days of May, the Kharkov pocket was systematically reduced. Of those encircled, only 22,000 managed to escape. 70,000 Russian soldiers lost their lives.